Dear friends, glad to see you again, and thank you for being with us. This time, let me introduce another writer whose books mostly were created in the second half of the 20th century. The author, who is very often referred to as the countryside author in Russia and in Soviet Union, Valentin Rasputin. And his books are very popular and are studied at school, but I chose this time a very special story that is called French Lessons. This is a very autobiographical story, and this is a very deep insight into the walk of life of a person who was born and raised in a Siberian countryside, far away from big cities, and suddenly he has got acquainted to languages and culture. And later he became a writer, and he shares with us his experience. So it's called French Lessons. The first thing that we need to know is that French language was in a way exotic for Russia back in Soviet Union time, especially for the countryside. But why French? Why not English or German? After World War II, studying German language at school, at Soviet school, was unfathomable. You could hardly imagine a situation when people would study German at school. English at that time was not that widespread, and there were no particular reasons studying English in a countryside school. But French was the language of nobility, was the language of Russian culture before the revolution, was the language of good manners. And that's why the name French Lessons goes very far beyond studying language. They are very much connected with studying the culture. Now, the story was published in 1973, and the same year it became very popular, and even the movie was made. And we will have some pictures from the movie that can give us a better understanding of how do we perceive that little boy and in his young years. Now, let's open the first page, and these are the words that meet us when we open that book. Have a look at the slide, please. It's strange. Why do we, like before our parents, feel guilty before our teachers every time? And not for what happened at school, no, but for what happened to us after. Quite possibly this phrase is referred to the teacher that is mentioned in the short story, Lydia Mikhailovna, that has made such a great impression on the author, Valentin Rasputin. He describes his first school years as the most difficult part of his life, because still the country was ruined by the World War II, and there was not enough to eat. Famine was very strong. People were hardly finding anything to feed themselves. And to study in these conditions was not an easy task. So, let's have a look at the slide. I went to fifth grade in 1948. It would be more correct to say I went in our village. There was only primary school. Therefore, in order to study further, I had to equip myself from home 50 kilometers away to the regional center. A week earlier, my mother had gone there, agreed with her friends that I would be accommodating with her, and on the last day of August, Uncle Vanya, the driver of the only lorry on the collective farm, unloaded me on Podkamennaya Street, where I was to live, helped to bring a note into the house with bed, patted goodbye on the shoulder encouragingly, and drove off. We see here very touching scene. A countryside boy is coming to a city. Everything is very new to him, especially the people. Their culture is very different from the culture of countryside people. Their ideas, their notions of hygiene, of behavior, of politeness are quite different. And all of that is coming to him at once. He has to get adapted to this in a very short time to remain at school. Now, the famine here was not at all like the famine in the country. There always, and especially in autumn, it was possible to intercept, pluck, dig, lift something. Fish walked in the Angara, a bird flew in the forest. Here, for me, everything around was empty. Strangers, strangers' gardens, stranger land. A small rivulet of 10 rows was filtered with nonsense. Once on Sunday, I sat with a fishing rod for the whole day and caught 3 small, about a teaspoon, gudgeons. You can't get enough of such fishing either. So, his first impression from the city is kind of emptiness. In the countryside, you can always find some kind of food, either in the forest or in the farm. But in the city, people are strangers to each other. You've got no one to ask, and nobody's coming to help. So he is alone in a big city, and he's hungry all the time. So what he does next is actually he is trying to gamble with the local children. Some of them seem to be aggressive. Some of them speak in the language of gangsters. So there is a very high chance of him getting into a bad company and ending extremely unwell. And his teacher, a young and very passionate about her art of teaching, Lydia Mikhailovna, is seeing in him a very talented person, and she's trying to see what makes him gamble. What does he spend the money for? All kinds of treats? What can a child spend the money for? Sweets? What? Smoking? So this is the dialogue between them. Even now, Lydia Mikhailovna asked as if at that time she was busy with something else, more important, but all the same, it was impossible to get away from her questions. So what do you do with the money you win? Do you buy candy or books, or are you saving up for something? After all, you probably have a lot of them now. No, not much. I only win a ruble. Don't you play anymore? And the ruble? Why the ruble? What are you doing with him? I buy milk. Here, dear friends, we have to understand the psychology of a hungry boy. He doesn't need much. He lives all his time with an empty stomach. He only needs a ruble to buy some bread and some milk. All he wants is not to be hungry. That's it. And that's the only obstacle for him for studying. And that's what the teacher sees. She can understand that this problem of this specific child is very easy to solve. And she can help him. But here is the problem. You know what? This is not just a child. This is a very proud child. His problem, he is not ready to take any help from anyone, especially from a young teacher, who is also very beautiful. And he's not just a boy, he is already a teenage boy, and he cannot take this help. For him, this is very humiliating. And all attempts of Lydia Mikhailovna to help him, he rejects. So how is she going to help him? Let's see how she tries. It turned out that this is not the worst thing. Lydia Mikhailovna suddenly decided that there was not enough time at school until the second shift, and she told me to come to her apartment in the evenings. She lived next to the school in teachers' houses. On the other, more half of Lydia Mikhailovna's house lived the director himself. So, under some disguise, she's trying to feed him, inviting him to make some extra classes free of charge, of course. She says that I am expecting you to come to my place and we have some extra lessons of French. But in the meantime, she can feed him, at least that he is not going to be hungry. Does that work? Let's have a look. Lydia Mikhailovna was then probably 25 or so. I remember well her correct and therefore not too lively face, with narrowed eyes to hide the braid in them, a tight, rarely revealing smile and completely black, short-cropped hair. But with all this, there was no severity in her face, which, as I later noticed, becomes almost a professional sign of teachers over the years, even the kindest and gentlest by nature. But there was some kind of cautious, cunning bewilderment related to herself and seemed to say, I wonder how I got here and what am I doing here? She was a very extraordinary teacher. She was sort of out of place, just as well as the language she taught. How can you possibly apply the knowledge of French language in a Siberian city? What is she doing here? How come a teacher of such an exotic language finds herself in that school? This is a good question to ask, and possibly she cannot answer this question by herself, but she regards it as she is here to help someone, and maybe this child is the one that she can help. Okay? Now, she tries to give some food to the boy, but it doesn't end well. He can't take it. He feels very much ashamed. He feels even more ashamed to run away from her, but that's what he does. Please have a look at the quotation. It's a shame now to remember how frightened and lost I was when Lydia Mikhailovna, having finished our lesson, invited me to supper. If I were hungry 1,000 times, every appetite would immediately jump out of me like a bullet. Sit down at the same table with Lydia Mikhailovna? No, no, I'd better learn all French by tomorrow so that I never come here again. Have a look. For most of Russian kids at that time, a teacher was a kind of a godlike figure. He had to be revered, and sitting with a teacher at the same table was very unnatural. A child feels very uncomfortable. This is a situation that he never expected to happen. I jumped up and muttering that I was full, that I didn't want to, backed up along the wall towards the exit. Lydia Mikhailovna looked at me with surprise and resentment, but it was impossible to stop me by any means. I ran away. This was repeated several times, then Lydia Mikhailovna, in despair, stopped inviting me to the table. I breathed more freely. But the problem remains. The child is hungry, and he can possibly go and gamble again. How can she help him? Try to look at her. Try to look at the situation with her eyes. She's trying to help, but any way of help is rejected. That boy is painfully proud. And so she finds another way, sending him a box with some food, as if it comes from home. But guess what? She's not a countryside girl. She doesn't know what do they have in the countryside and what they don't. And that what makes her actually lose this situation, and the boy discovers that he was sort of cheated by her. Have a look at that. Once I was told that downstairs in the locker room there was a parcel for me, which some guy had brought to school. Uncle Vanya, of course, is our chauffeur. What a man. Probably our house was closed, and Uncle Vanya could not wait for me from school, so he left me in the locker room. Looking into the parcel, I was stunned. On top, covered with a neatly large white sheet of paper, lay pasta. Long yellow tubes, stacked one to the other in even rows, flashed in the light with such wealth, which was dearer to me than anything else. This is a very unusual thing to receive for a boy. At first, he doesn't even eat the pasta. Guess what he does with it? He looks through it. He plays with it. He doesn't eat pasta every day. There was famine in the country. He didn't see it for a very long while. But at last, conscience comes to him. What kind of pasta could they have in the countryside? None. So obviously it is Lidia Mikhailovna who is sending this pasta to him. So he discovers the trick. And Lidia Mikhailovna is very upset. She asks, why can't you take it? What if your mother sent it? Why can't you take it as if I'm your mother? Have a look at their dialogue. What's wrong if you take this pasta now and cook yourself a good dinner today? Why can't I help you just once in my life? I promise not to sleep any more parcels, but please take this one. You have to eat your fill to learn how many well-fed loafers we have in school who do not understand anything at all and will probably never think, and you're a capable boy. You cannot drop out of school. Her voice was starting to make me sleepy. I was afraid that she would persuade me, and angry with myself for understanding Lidia Mikhailovna's correctness and for the fact that I was going to not understand her all the same, I, shaking my head and muttering something, rushed out the door. Lidia Mikhailovna is very worried about him because obviously his undernourishment influences his capability and ability to study. So she's still trying. She doesn't give up. How can she help this child? And she finds a way. Guess what? See the next slide. They decided to gamble. Of course, that was her idea. And she says, can you play with me? I'm alone here. I want to play this game that you gamble with other children. Because I have no fun, and this game is so very interesting. And the child goes in for it. They sit down and play together. And she starts gambling away some money. So he wins, and with the money he wins from his teacher, he can buy milk and bread. And this is the only help he takes. So she is gently gambling the money away. She loses him a ruble here and a ruble there, and she sees that he is now speaking French a little better, that he is now more fed up, that he now eats better and feels better. But the situation is very tricky. For a Soviet teacher to play or to gamble with a student was a great taboo. It was hard to imagine. So when the director sees her gambling with a child, he's shocked. And there is very little chance that she remains a teacher in the same school. Have a look at the situation. We shouted, interrupting each other, when we heard a surprised, if not startled, but firm ringing voice. Lidia Mikhailovna? We froze. Vasily Andreevich stood at the door. Lidia Mikhailovna, what's the matter with you? What's going on here? Lidia Mikhailovna slowly, very slowly, got up from her knees, flushed and disheveled, and smoothing her hair, said, I, Vasily Andreevich, hoped that you would knock before entering here. I knocked. Nobody answered me. What's going on here? Can you explain, please? I have a right to know as a director. We play well, Lidia Mikhailovna calmly answered. Are you playing for money with this? Vasily Andreevich pointed a finger at me, and in fear I crawled behind the partition to hide in the room. Are you playing with a student? Did I understand you correctly? Right. Wow. You know, the director was gasping for breath. He was out of breath. I'm at a loss to name your deed right away. It is a crime. Obviously, after this, the teacher cannot carry on working here. And she leaves the school. Probably she comes back to her home place, which is Kuban. Kuban is down south, very far away from Siberia, where we are now. It is a warm, rich place. They've got apples there, they've got fruit, and the food is better there. But the child stays here. And you know, this child has never in his life seen an apple. This is so funny to think about this today, but that's what it is. And the teacher who tried to show him some better life, better than there is here, risked everything, her reputation, her career, maybe her freedom in a way. She could have been imprisoned after this. And all of that was done just for the sake of one child. And only when this child grows up, he understands completely the great sacrifice that teacher made for him. And maybe he becomes a writer to complete what the teacher saw in him. So, 3 days later, Lidia Mikhailovna left. The day before, she met me after school and walked me home. "I'll go to my place in the Kuban," she said, saying goodbye. "And you, study calmly. No one will touch you for the stupid incident. This is my fault. Study." She patted my head and left, and I never saw her again. But you see, the imprint, the impression from this teacher remained with him for the rest of his life. This was the first person he saw in his life who was not his relative, but was ready to make such a great sacrifice for his own sake. Guess what happens next? In the middle of winter, after the January holidays, a package came to school by mail. When I opened it, taking the eggs out from under the stairs again, there were pasta tubes in neat, dense rows, and below, in a thick cotton wrap, I found 3 red apples. Previously, I only saw apples in pictures, but I guessed that it was them. This is the end of the story. And now let's come again. Why is it called French Lessons? From what we have learned from all these books, dear friends, you have probably realized that Russian people are very friendly, very warm, and ready to help. But here the author tells us about the elegance of help, about the ability of teacher to help the child without offending him, to help the child without taking from him his own independence, freedom of choice, and without destroying his feeling of a little but an independent personality. So that's what the story is about. Thank you very much for being with us, and see you again next time.